Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Welcome to the Health Disparities Seminar.
My name is Laura Bailey. I'm Senior Director of the Health Disparities Initiative.
Okay. There is a little... Again, welcome to the Health Disparities Seminar. We're going to ask you, since we are broadcasting live, if you would please turn off your cell phones. Now our CEO, Dr. Norman Anderson, will introduce our speaker.
Thank you, Lula. Good afternoon, everyone. Both here and out there in the world somewhere watching online. We're really fortunate to have an incredible speaker for the session today, and I think you all recognize that the quality of the speaker we have, such that we had to move to a bigger room within APA. Unfortunately, I think we have enough to accommodate most people, but this is an overflow crowd, people still coming in. So it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, is Dr. Carl Hart. Dr. Hart is an associate professor of psychology in both the departments of psychology and psychiatry at Columbia University and director of the Residential Studies and Methamphetamine Research Laboratories at the New York State Psychiatric Institute. A major focus of Dr. Hart's research is to understand the complex interactions between drugs of abuse and the neurobiology and environmental factors that mediate human behavior and physiology. He is an extraordinarily distinguished speaker and scientist and author. He's published dozens and dozens of research papers. He's been funded by National Institutes of Health, particularly NIDA, National Institute on Drug Abuse. He is the author of a widely used textbook called Drugs, Society, and Human Behavior. And he most recently became a fellow of the American Psychological Association through our Division 28 on psychopharmacology and substance abuse. How he does all this, I don't know. I don't know when he sleeps. I mentioned to you that he is an author for on a book for the general public called High Price, A Neuroscientist's Journey of Self-Discovery that challenges everything you know about drugs and society. So I introduce to you Dr. Carl Hart. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming out. It's always a pleasure to be in D.C., the nation's capital. Even better to come speak to APA, my group. This is called the Health Disparities Seminar Series, right? I always had a problem with that term, health disparities, in part because it kind of disparities that I'm interested in, most of the ones that we talk about are really racial disparities. And so what happens is that we use these terminologies to obfuscate what the real problems are, and it makes some people feel better politically, but me as a scientist, it just causes me all kinds of anxiety. And so I'm here to talk to you all today on your racial disparities seminar, okay? That's what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about this using drugs as a vehicle. I recently published a book, a trade book, and as Norman pointed out, I have a textbook, and the textbook is doing extremely well. It's one of the sort of, it actually owns that market, the college market. It's where it's aimed at college students. It does really well, but the problem is that the only people who read that textbook are college students. The general public doesn't have access to this information, and so it's a lot of technical, dry science material. One of the ways I thought I could remedy that was to publish this trade book aimed more at a general audience. Now, the trade book is a combination of a memoir, a science book, and policy book. I like to give talks related to the book, but it's so difficult to give a talk trying to encompass all three of those sort of domains. So what I'm going to do today is talk a little bit, just briefly, about my sort of personal life, my personal upbringing, the memoir portion, but just briefly. When you talk about these sort of personal issues, it is easy to slip in this area of where you're being frivolous or self-congratulatory, and I feel kind of uncomfortable doing that in public, but I'm happy to take questions about my upbringing and that sort of thing at the end of the seminar. Most of this talk will focus on the science, on my science, and at the end there will be some sort of policy recommendations. But I'll start just briefly with the question that people kind of ask me about a lot, and this deals largely with the memoir portion. The question is, how did I get from point A to point B? Point A being growing up in the hood to becoming Columbia's first tenured African American scientist. How did that happen? Well, the first thing I want to let you all know is that I wasn't perfect. You know, I participated in the drug game in sort of two areas. I sold drugs. I used drugs. I don't say that in the same way that a rapper says it, like to brag or something like that. That's not the point. The point is to kind of contextualize it, to let you know that I know quite a bit about my area of study, not only from the lab, but also from the streets, and also from the prisons and that sort of thing. One of the ways that one makes it with a background like that is that you have a lot of help from friends, families, guidance counselors, athletics. I played athletics in high school, and it kind of kept me plugged in. Playing athletics, it required that I had maintained a 2.0 GPA. It's not that high, but it kept me in school, and it allowed me to graduate. But the most important thing that kind of helped me to move along was mentors. Mentors and eventually going into the military when I didn't get the scholarship that I thought I should get, the basketball scholarship that I was hoping for. I went into the military, and I spent all of my time in the military overseas. That was critical for a 17-year-old black man, a boy growing up in the U.S. Most of my time was spent in the English-speaking country of the U.K. In the U.K., they had no sort of apprehensions about criticizing America. And it was affirming to me. It corroborated my reality, particularly as it related to race relations, our sort of poor race relations in this country. Where in this country, certain things weren't said in a more candid way, but in the U.K., when you turned on the BBC, they, at this time in the 80s, the mid to late 80s, they played the U.S. PBS series Eyes on the Prize. I learned a lot about the U.S. civil rights movement through that sort of video. There were a number of things about apartheid. It really corroborated my reality in ways that hadn't been corroborated here in the U.S. So after being in the U.K. I started to go to school. I started to take a number of college courses, so many college courses that I was nearly completed with my college education after 4 years in the military. I finished up after getting out of the military at the University of North Carolina in Wilmington, where mentors encouraged me to go on and get a PhD in neuroscience. They told me that I could make a contribution to my community, for example, by trying to figure out the effects of drugs on the brain. How I wanted to know why were drugs destroying our community and how I could make my contribution. And I thought I could make my contribution by understanding the neurobiology of drug addiction. So I went to graduate school and I studied cocaine, nicotine, the effects of these drugs in this area called the nucleus accumbens on dopamine. That's what I wanted to know. And I began to think critically. I began to learn how to think critically. I also started to, I think this quote is important for someone who is starting to learn how to think. This is a quote from, I guess, my favorite author, James Baldwin, when he said, "The paradox of education is precisely this, that as one begins to become conscious, one begins to examine the society in which one is being educated." And this was important for me because now I can actually think about what's happening in our society. And I want to think about this quote in the context of what I do. And what I do is I study the effects of drugs. And today I'd like to use one drug as an example of me being critical and questioning our society. And the drug that I study now is methamphetamine. And methamphetamine has currently been vilified in this society. And it's been vilified in part because of three assumptions, a number of other assumptions, but today I would like to address three of these assumptions. One assumption is that when people take methamphetamine, they develop superhuman strength. I have sat on panels, roundtable discussions, and so forth with law enforcement personnel, and they describe how when you have someone on methamphetamine, you have their normal tasers don't work as well. You have to have a higher caliber of weapon to kind of check these people, is what's argued. Another assumption is that methamphetamine has a unique pharmacological profile. It's like no other drug we've seen. Officers will tell you, "I've been around during the crack era." Believe me, crack is child's play compared to methamphetamine, is what they say. Another sort of assumption is that methamphetamine causes widespread cognitive impairments. One particular officer said that when he was trying to arrest the woman who was on methamphetamine, she cut the head of her child off and threw it at him. She was so cognitively impaired. I know, I see the faces of you guys are cringing, like, that can't be true. You're right, it can't be true. But these are the kind of stories that are told about new drugs or certain drugs. Now, I have data to address the final two assumptions, but I don't have data to address the first assumption about the superhuman strength development. We don't do that kind of stuff. We don't do these studies in the lab where we ask people to lift weights and that sort of thing. So I don't have data to address that issue. But I do want to take us back to 1914 to kind of address this issue through historical information. In 1914, February 8th, New York Times published an article entitled "Negro Cocaine Fiends Are a New Southern Menace." In this article, the eminent Dr. Williams argues that black folks on cocaine, by the way, this is snorted cocaine, this is kind of like a new method of using cocaine, a new sort of drug, if you will. Black people snorting cocaine became more murderous, they became better marksmen, and they were unaffected by 32 caliber weapons, bullets. So much so that Southern police forces had to move to the 38 caliber weapon to check these folks. These were the arguments that were made surrounding powder cocaine at the time. So this sort of superhuman strength development, it's not new. These sort of myths, these assumptions are recycled generation after generation. But the thing that struck me about this article, the Negro cocaine article, that the thing that struck me most was that I came across this article when I was in graduate school trying to finish my oral exams and dissertation. And as I read this article, I thought, wow, this is reminiscent of what happened in the 1980s with crack cocaine. except the language had been tempered and some of the sort of race, blatant racism had been tempered. But the language, the gist of the article was the same. The same sort of statements were being made. And so it got me to thinking about, hey, was I hoodwinked when I was so concerned about crack cocaine in the community? Was I hoodwinked when I thought that, you know, this was the thing that was destroying the community? So I started to question there. But the thing that was interesting about the whole crack cocaine era is that, yeah, it was the same. And yeah, I was hoodwinked. The community was hoodwinked. We were so hoodwinked that we passed in 1986 the most stringent, the most repressive drug laws that we had ever passed in our history. We punished crack cocaine 100 times more harshly than powder cocaine, in part because of the media sort of hysteria surrounding the drug and the people who were associated, who we thought were the main users, black folks in cities. And so we passed these harsh laws. Now, I want to make it clear, when I make these statements about black folks and why we passed these laws, I want to make it clear that we all participated in this sort of hysteria. It wasn't like racist white politicians passed these laws. The Congressional Black Caucus voted 17 out of the 21 members voted for these legislations. Not only was the Congressional Black Caucus supportive of this, NAACP even agreed to work with the Ku Klux Klan in order to get crack out of some community in Lackland, Florida. This is an article from the LA Times where it comments on how the Lakeland NAACP agreed to work with the Klan to rid the community of crack cocaine dealers. Incredible. The Ku Klux Klan, of course, mission is to destroy black people. But yet the folks at the NAACP folks in Lackland, they wanted to work with them. They worked with them. Now, well, that's not even the worst of it. The worst of it is what happened in terms of how we enforce these laws. When we look at the data and how we enforce the laws, who really paid the price, more than 80% of the people who were convicted under the federal laws were black, even though black people were not the primary users of the drug. So that's the real crime of these laws. I guess the real crime is that this is a picture here of powder cocaine and crack cocaine. On your left is powder cocaine. On your right is crack cocaine. On the left, the red circle shows the hydrochloride portion of cocaine. The hydrochloride portion is the only thing that separates these two drugs. Now, the hydrochloride portion doesn't have any biological activity. The only reason it's there is to make it more stable, so that if someone heats it up, the temperatures that are required to burn the hydrochloride portion are so high that the base, just the cocaine base, will decompose it, so you can't smoke it. So if you want to smoke it, you have to remove that hydrochloride portion. It's the only difference. Pharmacologically, they're the same drug. But yet, we punished them 100 times more, punished crack cocaine 100 times more harshly. And so this here sort of knowledge, what I just told you, we all knew this for a long time. We all know it now. While the crack cocaine laws are not so harsh these days, it's not 100-1. In 2010, President Obama signed legislation to decrease that disparity to 18-1, which is still ridiculous. But we all kind of go along still. Now, that's just some brief, that's a kind of brief history about to kind of help put this in context for you. Now, I want to go back, shift gears back to methamphetamine, and tell you a little something about what I do. These days, what I do is I bring people into our laboratory and we give them drugs of abuse to study the effects on brain behavior, interactions, physiological effects, a wide range of effects, so we can know
what drugs do and what drugs don't do. Of course, we pass all of the ethical requirements to do this sort of thing. But in this way, it allows us to participate in discussions without exchanging ignorance. We can participate in these discussions about drugs from an empirical base. So I just want to briefly say something about my initial studies with methamphetamine and our lab, what we have done in this lab. One of the things that you can do in this lab is that you can have people live with you and sleep there. Now, when you do that, you can alter their schedules such that you can wake them up at 8 o'clock in the morning or wake them up at midnight. And when you wake them, you can have them complete cognitive batteries for 8 hours throughout the day. If you have them complete batteries during the day shift when they wake up at 8 o'clock in the morning, you can also have them complete batteries when they wake up at midnight. When you shift people's work shift schedules abruptly, one of the things that you see consistently is some cognitive disruptions. And that's what this slide basically shows. The data in the red shows the night shift data, and the data in the open black circle shows the day shift data. On your far left are data from a response time, reaction time. What you see is that response time in the middle, learning and memory errors are increased. And on your right, inhibitory control errors are increased when you allow people, when you shift their work shift schedules abruptly. Now, one of the questions that I was interested in was, what would the effects of methamphetamine be in with this paradigm? Because I knew that D-amphetamine, for example, would attenuate these night shift disruptions. And I knew our military were using D-amphetamine and currently uses D-amphetamine, but people were making these wild claims about the dangers of methamphetamine. So I wanted to know, would it behave differently? Would it look like D-amphetamine, or would it look like something else? Well, what you see on from your left to your right, methamphetamine, 5 milligrams, 10 milligrams, given orally, attenuates the disruption seen in response time, learning and memory, and also with inhibitory control. So methamphetamine looked just like D-amphetamine. That's what you would expect. And this relatively low dose, you would it looked just like an amphetamine. And other studies have shown similar sort of thing. Now, one of the concerns about this particular study is that the doses are so low, and we gave it via an oral route. Now, our study, our findings were inconsistent with what we were doing in terms of education in the country about methamphetamine, what we were telling people what methamphetamine actually do, and so what it actually does. And so what I want to show you here is a clip of the kind of education that we have been engaged in this country as it relates to methamphetamine.
This is a normal. Put on this. It is.
So the idea is that if you use methamphetamine, you will become so cognitively impaired you can't respond to emergencies in a normal way. That serves as education in this country, drug education in this country. And so for me, my question was, I was thinking, well, maybe we're missing something in the lab. Maybe our doses are too low, given the drug via oral route. Maybe what we do in the lab is not relevant to the natural ecology. So I wanted to get at this issue. I wanted to test this issue of whether methamphetamine exerts unique effects. And I wanted to make sure that I dealt with this dose issue and route of administration issue. Wanted to make sure I gave a dose that was large enough and gave this dose via a route that's associated with abuse. So in this particular study, that we did. I tested the doses as large as 50 milligrams given via the intranasal route, and I compared methamphetamine with D-amphetamine. So when you, just to put it in context, when we think about a 50 milligram dose of methamphetamine, it's a nice dose. It's a dose that people who are addicted to methamphetamine would love to have. It's a nice dose. So here, I just have a slide on this slide, the distinction between methamphetamine and D-amphetamine. Methamphetamine is on the right, D-amphetamine is on the left. The only difference is this methyl group on methamphetamine. Some people have said that this methyl group makes the drug more lipid-soluble, gets in the brain more quickly, therefore it's more potent, more dangerous. That's what some people are saying. So we did the study, and here are some data. These data are from systolic blood pressure. Just to orient you to the graph, in the black, that's placebo. In the light green is 12 milligrams D-amphetamine. In the dark green, 12 milligrams methamphetamine. In the light red, 50 milligrams of D-amphetamine. And in the dark red, 50 milligrams of methamphetamine. The point here is that when you look at these data, systolic blood pressure, D-amphetamine, and methamphetamine, identical. They're the same. You look at subjective effects and also those other subjective effects, diastolic blood pressure, heart rate, exactly the same. Look at subjective effects, euphoria, high, the effects of the drugs are the same. When we gave participants an opportunity to self-administer the drug, choose to take these drugs under double-blind conditions, would they take D-amphetamine less than they took methamphetamine? These are methamphetamine addicts, of course. They took the drug on the same number of occasions. When we do these studies, we always have an alternative. In this particular case, $5 was the alternative. When they had an opportunity to self-administer the 50 milligram dose of methamphetamine, they took it about half of the occasion and took the $5 on the other half. The same is true with D-amphetamine. So the bottom line is that the notion that methamphetamine has a unique pharmacological profile is just not supported by evidence from research. We weren't the only people who had studied methamphetamine compared to D-amphetamine. In 1971, Billy Martin and his group studied large oral doses of methamphetamine compared with large oral doses of D-amphetamine. They found the same thing that we found. Craig Rush and his group replicated that study in 2009. So the notion that methamphetamine is unique is just not supported by evidence. So let's go to cognitive impairments. When we think about cognitive impairments, at the time when I started thinking about cognitive impairments, there were few data out there that had actually looked at large doses of methamphetamine given to people and testing cognitive function. So my next best thing was to look at what was happening in the animal literature. As I looked at the animal literature, one thing that became very clear quickly is that methamphetamine produced neurotoxic effects on monoamine neurons, dopamine, norepinephrine, serotonin. These neurons are important for movement, mood, cognitive function, a wide range of things. What I also saw as I reviewed this literature is that methamphetamine produced some disruptions in cognitive functioning in laboratory animals. Now, that was clear. That was in the literature, everybody who had studied this were reporting these findings. One thing that was less clear was that one thing that was not reported as much was this important caveat. This caveat being that these deleterious effects that I just described can be attenuated, blocked, if you gave the animal escalating doses of the drug for several days and then gave this whopping dose. So the whopping dose that caused the neurotoxicity oftentimes were 10, 20, 30 times that what humans take. You can block this simply by giving escalating doses, allowing animals to become tolerant to the drug. Tolerance protects us from a wide range of drug effects. Of course, that's not talked about in the public health education sort of domain. If you all have ever smoked cigarettes, you're all over 40, I'm sure you all have smoked a cigarette, right? If you've ever smoked a cigarette, the first time you smoked a cigarette, you might have had a headache, dizziness, and those sorts of things. Eventually, if you continue, that stuff would go away. Tolerance. Tolerance protects the user from a number of these sort of deleterious effects. It would be important for us to incorporate this in a public health message, but we don't. So these animal data, for me, underscored the importance of making sure that the animal models had some ecological validity, relevance. So, okay, this is a story from the animal literature. I also had some data that looked at what happens if you allow methamphetamine users to self-administer the drug compared to some alternative greater than $5. You know, because the idea being that if the drug is so disruptive to cognitive function, if you bring in addicts in the lab, methamphetamine users or addicts in the lab, give them a sample dose of the drug, these people, if they were so cognitively impaired, they wouldn't be able to make these rational decisions. So what happens when you give these folks a choice between methamphetamine and nothing? Methamphetamine data, they had 10 opportunities to self-administer methamphetamine. Methamphetamine data is shown in the red, placebo in the left. They had 10 opportunities. If you gave them a choice between methamphetamine and nothing, what happens? They take methamphetamine. What happens when you give them a choice between methamphetamine and $5? Half of the occasions they'll take methamphetamine, half of the occasions they'll take money. What happens if you give them an opportunity to self-administer the drug and $20? Well, $20 wipes out the self-administration of methamphetamine in the lab. This is rational behavior. This is how folks who are methamphetamine addicts behave, rationally. Some people say, well, they were just saving the money to take drugs on the outside after they finish your 2 weeks, 4 weeks study, right? I hope they were, because that's logical. If they actually were planning, that requires some inhibitory control, long-term planning. If they were doing that, good for them. They earned the money. I don't want to be paternalistic. That's what they do. But I know that's not what most of them did, because I know we paid some of their bills with their study funding. We wrote checks for them. We did things like that. So it's rational behavior. So another question that I wanted to know was, what were the effects then on other cognitive measures when you gave folks a large dose of methamphetamine, for example, in the lab, via a route that is associated with abuse, whether it's intranasal, whether it's intravenous? What happened when you gave folks these large doses and then ask them to complete some cognitive tasks? Well, there have now been a number of studies. Across the board, when you give people doses larger than 20 milligrams and give it via a route that's associated with abuse, you see improvements in a wide range of domains. Now, in some studies, there are improvements only in one or two domains, but you never see, or there hasn't been, reports of disruptions in the literature caused by the drug. It makes sense. Methamphetamine is approved to treat ADHD, a cognitive disorder. It makes sense. It enhances cognitive performance at the right dose, right? So it makes sense. So it does, again, that doesn't support the notion that the drug is causing all of these cognitive disruptions when people are taking the drug. Okay, well, what happens if you take people who are methamphetamine addicts and they are drug-free, and they've been drug-free from periods ranging from a year to 30 years? You compare those folks with people who have never taken the drug. When you compare their brains, do their brains look different? Because there's still this belief that methamphetamine particularly, causes neurotoxicity, even when given at doses that produce euphoria, that are not super large. So what happens? I was interested in this question,
last year I published a critical review to look at the literature that has looked at the brain imaging and cognitive performance of methamphetamine use. And what I found, when I look at the imaging literature, when I look at MRI or fMRI, one of the things with that sort of those techniques is that no one replicates any of the findings. So there's no replication in those findings. So I won't talk about those findings because that literature is a mess, quite frankly. When you look at the PET imaging literature, you get more consistency. One of the things that you see in the PET imaging literature, for you all who don't know what PET imaging is, for example, you inject a radioactive compound, and it binds to specific portions of the neuron, for example. In this case, the vesicular monoamine transporter. So it's a transporter for norepinephrine, serotonin, dopamine. And if we think that methamphetamine causes toxicity to these types of neurons, you would expect to get less binding in these neurons. So one of the things that you see here, I'll orient you to the slide, in the circles you see the control group, people who never use methamphetamine. In the triangles you see the methamphetamine users. And this slide is of the striatum, various parts of the striatum. What you see is that methamphetamine users have lower binding potentials. This is an indirect measure of the integrity of the monoamine transporter. I say it's an indirect measure because we're not really sure, but it's a measure. It's still a measure in the best we have right now. What you see is that methamphetamine users have about a 10 to 20% lower binding potential than the controls in the throughout the striatum. What you also see is that there is a lot of overlap. Many of the methamphetamine users look like many of the controls. And if you take out some of these outliers, the means might even be the same. But that's what you see. And this is representative of that literature. Another thing that's important for us to keep in mind here is that this is a snapshot, one moment in time. We don't know what was there before these folks started using methamphetamine. So we can't make causal statements. This is the best we can do. And here are the literature. These are all the papers that have basically found this. There's one paper that is in conflict, but all the rest show this 10 to 20% difference. Now, what does that mean? What does that 10 to 20% difference mean? I don't know. And so one of the things I try to do is try to figure it out, what about cognitive functioning in these people? If this difference means something, cognitive functioning would be a nice measure to determine because cognitive function, of course, is related to the brain. One thing that we know is that whenever you're testing for impairment, you have to make sure that you compare the performance of the group of interest with that of a control group or normative scores, taking into account age and education. When we look at all of this literature, one study has actually done this, or actually taking into account this critical requirement. One study has actually taken this into account and found a difference. And in that study, they found that 7 of the 27 methamphetamine users met criteria for impairment, whereas 2 of the 18 met criteria for impairment. Now, this study was published in 2003 and hasn't been replicated. So it's one study that has shown that methamphetamine users are impaired. But yet, there's a general impression in the public, also in the scientific literature, because if you read the literature without looking at the data, you get the impression that methamphetamine abuse is associated with a widespread sort of wide range of cognitive impairment. The literature, the evidence, the data, does not support that position. So just a quick sort of summary of what I've said about cognitive function and methamphetamine. When you give the drug acutely in the lab, you see improvements in cognitive function. When you look at the brain imaging, the only sort of consistent findings you see are with the PET imaging. There's a 10 to 20% difference
between methamphetamine users and controls. But when you look at cognitive function more broadly, overwhelmingly, methamphetamine users perform within their age and educational match normal range. Now, I want to make it clear that the goal here is not to minimize problems associated with methamphetamine abuse. That's not the goal, because the problems associated with methamphetamine abuse are very real. One of the things that methamphetamine does really well is that it disrupts sleep. And we know that sleep disruptions are associated, particularly chronic sleep disruptions, are associated with a wide range of problems. Psychiatric illnesses, medical problems, various types of cancers are associated with this, paranoia, all of these sorts of things associated with sleep disruption. So I don't want to downplay that. But what I do want to say is that that's not unique to methamphetamine abuse. That is also, we can see that with a wide range of drugs of abuse when people meet criteria for abuse. But when only 10 to 20% of the people who use these drugs meet criteria, and all of our attention are focused on these negative sort of effects, that's a problem. And that's what I'm trying to raise here today. I'm trying to raise that because of these implications of these findings or what's said in the literature, implications related to science in general. When we start out with these assumptions that drugs are bad and awful, we typically find drugs are bad and awful, and we don't find a broad range of effects. We don't have a comprehensive understanding of effects. And as a scientist, that troubles me deeply, because I don't want to be less than comprehensive in my understanding. When it comes to treatment, there's this belief that methamphetamine users are cognitively impaired. Arguably, the most effective treatment for substance abuse is cognitive behavioral therapy. Cognitive behavioral therapy won't be given to methamphetamine users because they're cognitively impaired. There's no evidence to support that, of course, but that is what happens in some cases. Now, from a public policy perspective, several governments have moved to lessen or restrict amphetamine's use in general, also other drugs, this thing we call war on drugs. The war on drugs is in part supported by some of the hysteria that is in the scientific literature. Now, when we think about what that means, the war on drugs and what all that sort of stuff means, I guess we can think about the U.S. prison population today as one sort of way of thinking about this. The number one sort of crimes that people are arrested for in the United States are drugs. Drug arrest represents the greatest proportion of criminal charges today. And when we think about what has happened in our prisons in terms of the growth over the past few decades, we now have a greater proportion of our citizens in prison than any other nation. We have 5% of the world's population and 25% of the world's prison population. These sort of numbers have been driven primarily by our sort of war on drugs. This war on drugs that has been also, the efforts to the war on drugs have also been supported by people like me in science. Now, I just want to say what troubles me a lot about the war on drugs and has made me to think about this differently is that this hyper-incarceration that we have participated in this country has not been evenly distributed. That's the thing that got me to really think and got me to start to think about my role in this war on drugs. Now, just quickly, we all know these numbers and we kind of get tired of the numbers. 2010 were the most recent data I could find. 1 in 8 black men aged 20 to 29 was in prison or jail. 1 in 3 born today will spend time in prison.
incredible. But that's not even it. When we think about this fact, black men make up 6% of the U.S. population, 35% of the U.S. prison population. That sort of thing. Well, I think James Baldwin said it best for me. He said that to be Negro in this country and to be relatively conscious is to be in a rage almost all the time. This is what rage looks like. And so you say, well, what do you do? Well, what you do is you go about your business and do your work and you try to educate people, try to help people understand what's going on, and you try and engage in these public discussions, right? So, and then I have to also think about, how did I get bamboozled? How did I get bamboozled? I grew up thinking that I was conscious. So how did I get bamboozled? Well, as was pointed out, the primary sort of funder for me, as well as all of us who do drug research, is the National Institute on Drug Abuse. They fund about 90% of these studies on drug abuse. Now, their mission is to focus primarily on pathology associated with drugs. That's a very fine mission. There's nothing wrong with that mission. That's what their mission should be. They are part of the NIH, and that's what the NIH does. It focuses on pathology. The problem is this, is that when you're focusing almost exclusively on pathology, it's like when you lose your keys at night and you see a spotlight. You might look under the spotlight in part because that's where the spotlight is. It doesn't mean that your keys are there, but that's where you're more likely to look. And when we think about drug funding, drug research, the spotlight is almost exclusively on pathology. And so when that happens, I think Upton Sinclair said it the best. He said it's difficult to get a man, and in this case a woman as well, to understand something when his or her salary depends upon his or her not understanding it. I think that's the crux of what I'm saying. Now, this coupled with this fact, we as scientists, we tend to err on the side of caution. Caution in this case being we report the bad effects because we don't want anybody to go out and use drugs based on anything I said. And so we tend to err on the side of caution. And we err on the side of caution as if there are no consequences to that caution, when in fact there are grave consequences, particularly to those black men that I described. Because what we have done is that we have helped to create this environment in which any use of these drugs is deemed evil and pathological. And we have helped to create this view, this focus on eliminating these drugs at all costs. This notion of a drug-free America. I can't say this any stronger. That's one of the stupidest things that anybody could say. There has never been a drug-free society. There never will be a drug-free society. And nor should there be a drug-free society. But we actually believe that we can have a drug-free society in this country, particularly in the 80s. But I'm sure maybe you all have this drug-free workplace. You all have that thing, the drug-free workplace? We all have this. It's ridiculous. It is ridiculous, and we as smart people and scientists, we tuck it. It's embarrassing to me, quite frankly. So, when you point out these problems, when you point out all of these things that I point out, it's incumbent upon you to have some solutions, some ideas where we can go. One solution that I have is that I argued for in High Price, the book, I argue that we should decriminalize all drugs. Now, it's always important to tell people the distinction between legalization and decriminalization. Legalization is what we do with alcohol and tobacco. If you're of age, you can purchase these things without any consequence. Decriminalization is slightly different. Decriminalization drugs remain illegal. The only difference, the major difference here is that if someone gets caught with these drugs, rather than sending them to prison, they instead pay a fine or some other sort of administrative way of dealing with it, just like we handle traffic violations. Driving an automobile can potentially kill people if they do it dangerously. But we don't have a war on driving, a reckless driving. So I think of drugs in the same way I think of driving an automobile. I think of drugs in the same way as I think of risky sexual behavior. We haven't had a war on sexual behavior, even though people can die from engaging in that activity. But we haven't launched this war. So my argument is simple. We should decriminalize everything. Every year we arrest 1.5 million people for drugs in this country. 80% of those arrests are for simple possession. We would make an incredible dent in the criminal justice system if we simply decriminalize it. Not only that, we would not look so much like hypocrites, particularly as it comes to racial justice. Now, when we think about what other countries have done, this isn't a new idea. Portugal has decriminalized drugs since 2001, and they are faring better than us on all of the major drug indicators. Lower drug use, lower drug-related deaths, all of these things, they are faring a lot better than us. Not only that, we have decriminalized marijuana in a handful of states already, and marijuana is also legal in two states. So we are not so ambivalent or less ambivalent about marijuana than we are with these other drugs. We are more ambivalent with these other drugs because we're ignorant about what these drugs do and don't do. And part of the mission of the book is to increase the intellectual tone surrounding discussions about drugs. Now, I'd like to leave some time to deal with some questions because I hope you all have some interesting and some tough questions, and I hope we can have a heated and lively discussion. But I want to leave you with this. Many of the assumptions made about methamphetamine, as well as other drugs, crack cocaine, I didn't even say it. I got through a whole lecture without saying anything about Rob Ford. How can I do that? Rob Ford is, of course, the mayor of Toronto, and he recently got caught using crack cocaine. It shattered many of the assumptions that people had about crack cocaine. They clearly didn't read High Price. In High Price, I try and tell people who the typical crack cocaine user is the typical crack cocaine user. Responsibly employed white men. That's the typical crack cocaine user. So many of these assumptions that we have about these drugs are just simply not true. These assumptions serve to create this sort of nationwide or worldwide drug menace. That's their major function. So I want to also let you all know that I recognize that our knowledge about drugs are not complete. I don't claim to know everything about drugs, and I don't claim that we know everything about drugs. But that doesn't preclude us from acting in terms of treating people, educating people, and also determining public policy. Now, we still have to act. But as we act, the most important thing that we have to do is be cognizant of our ignorance or our limited education and be prepared to make changes when new and better information becomes available. We failed to do that with crack cocaine. I'm asking that we don't do this again. And finally, use your common sense. If you hear a story, someone tells you a story about drugs that seems incredible, it probably is incredible. And with that, I'd like to open it up.
Thank you.
Please, do we have the questions in the back?
Yeah.
on your review of the MRI visit, you said that they could not, you did not find in one repeat experiment.
Yes.
Did you say that people had attempted to repeat the studies? I'm not sure about that.
So if you look at the MRI data, fMRI data, same researchers, same group of lab, they do one study and they don't repeat the same finding. That's the point. They don't replicate their own findings.
But no one else has tried to replicate that.
They may have tried, but it's not reported in literature. It's
they're
just
not going to get money to
replicate. Oh, that's not true. Let me tell you how science works. So if you, for example, do an MRI study, and you're finding, because there are tons of...
I didn't mean it in that sense, that you won't get money to replicate.
No, but I am simply talking about, for example, a smaller brain region in a methamphetamine unit. Now, there are a number of other people who have done MRI studies. Now, if they found that, I found just like Jones and all, a smaller area in the striatum, they're going to report that because it gives their study more credence. They don't find it. That's the point.
Jasmine Howard, New York Policy.
Hey, Jasmine.
Appreciate your talk today, Dr. Hart. I wanted to sort of switch a little bit and ask what you think about stimulant replacement therapies and the dearth of research out there on that and the availability. Had such great results from methadone, suboxone, and buprenorphine, but we don't have the same thing to deal with cocaine and amphetamine without.
Yeah, so stimulant replacement therapies. I agree in terms of when we think of drug treatment, agonist therapies have been the most effective. So the question becomes, why not have a long-acting amphetamine to treat methamphetamine abuse? I think there's an aversion to using amphetamines. And I think that there have been some studies, particularly overseas, I think British groups, Australian groups, but they have been poorly controlled, and they show they're positive for the most part, but they're open label. John Grabowski has done some work here in the United States, better control, but low numbers. Certainly, there's an indication that we should be going in that direction for treatment, but it just hasn't been popular at our funding institute.
Hi, Julia Stewart here from APA Violence Prevention Office. I just want to see what are your thoughts about prevention and, you know, how to help. You know, you talked about this disparity that, you know, black men, Hispanic men can be in prison. They're mostly from low income, very poor, you know, disadvantaged segments of the population. And for many of them, you know, as a user, they start like a dealer and then also become a user and being there's something that they, you know, do to survive. I just read an article about Jay-Z when he was asking, so don't you feel anything about you were helping, contributing to the crack cocaine epidemic in the AIDS? And he said, no, I was trying to survive. So what do we do with this, you know, the kids from the barrios and the ghettos and, you know, the projects that use drugs as a way of getting this back and, you know, making money and do things? And then what do we do about that?
Yeah, so this is the first talk that I've given that Jay-Z was quoted as an authority. No, I feel you. I have a lot to say about that. So if you read High Price, that's what the book really deals with. How do these kids make it? It's a blueprint for these black boys to make it, really. It's kind of simple. We pretend that it's not. Let's go back to Ronald Reagan when he started to cut these programs. When I was a kid coming up, I'll do like Jay-Z now. I would use some antidote. When I was a kid growing up, we had summer programs. We had a number of sort of programs. My mother was on aid to families with dependent children throughout our sort of childhood. We all are now taxpaying citizens. All of those programs are cut. Clinton made sure that they were all gone by when he took office. It's not complicated. We pretend that it is. If we want to invest in people, we have to make sure they have jobs, skills. That's where the money's at. That's where our sort of answers are at. Make sure they have jobs. Make sure they have skills. But we pretend. Well, first of all, we don't have the honest conversation.
Yes.
We invest in other things other than those black and brown boys. That's the problem.
5%.
Nadine, that's on you. You have the mic.
I do. So I'm Nadine Rogers from the National Institute on Drug Abuse. And I guess the question I have is, you kind of described a structure that's been built around sort of science that isn't telling the whole story. And then on top of that science, you got, you know, legislation. And then, you know, so to me, it's a pretty tall structure. And I'm thinking that dismantling that structure is something that's going to take time. Do you have thoughts about, you know, the process? What are the first steps? What are the second? How should this happen? Because it's going to take time, and we want to put our efforts in the smartest places first.
No, that's a great question. The question is, there are a number of problems, and so how do you begin to start to deconstruct what we've done? One of the things I tried to do was write this book, and I wrote this book. There's a lot of personal sacrifice in telling the story that I told, and I did that so people could see me being honest. I'm asking people, for example, to come out the closet about your drug use. The majority of Americans, almost nearly half of Americans, have used illicit drugs. The president has done cocaine, has done marijuana. The guy before him just done marijuana, widely suspected of doing cocaine. I'm asking people to come out of the closet about those kinds of things. I'm asking people to have an honest discussion in this country about race. We have a black president, and we can talk about race a lot less than when he was president. Incredible. These kinds of things. I'm asking people to talk about this moral crisis that we have going on in the country when we look at our jails. And so I'm trying to ask people to be honest. I'm not really dealing with the political structure because I have no confidence in politicians. They will do what the people want them to do. They are risk averse. Those are not the people that I want to waste my time on.
Yeah, Carl,
thank you for having
an amazing presentation. I just really learned so much. One question I had to do with literacy with barriers to decriminalization, particularly that now that we have private sector involved in prison construction, there is an incentive to have more people in prison. And it sets up a very sort of perverse incentive. So,
yeah, the question is related to now that we have this sort of financial interest, this huge financial interest by powerful people. The prison guard lobby, they're some of the most powerful, that's probably one of the most powerful lobby in the country. And so, what do we do? I think about what people like Martin Luther King and those guys faced in 1963, 50 years ago, when the situation looked bleak and dire. The thing that they did was they tried to embarrass people publicly. So you say, you put profits before justice, before social justice? Is that what's going on? Call people out on it. Remember when Martin Luther King died, he was not revered in this country. He had given the Vietnam speech, and he said that war was an enemy of the poor because it was taking away money for poor people. That's not the speech that they play in America. They play a speech 5 years before his death. And so my thinking is that we get people to live more honestly and think about people like him when he was not revered, when he was calling us on our rubbish. Whenever I use rubbish, that will be that's a curse word. But
we're going to take one question online. Oh, we can take a simple one. Will the PowerPoint be uploaded somewhere later? It is difficult to see it on screen.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Sue Houston, aka Public Interest Director. And my question is, if you drive through Montana, Oregon, whatever places like that, Wyoming, it was kind of shocking, at least for me, to see billboards, huge billboards on the side of the road taking these horrendous images of white teenagers. Supposedly, I was on meth. Can you talk a little bit about that and how that fits in with what you're talking about? I mean, I've never seen any of those in urban areas.
Yeah, so methamphetamine, the users who we think of methamphetamine about are white. But primarily, as a country, we think about poor white people who we don't like and gay white people who we don't like. So when we think about when we vilify drugs, it's always with these despised groups. You can no longer vilify marijuana. You can try, but you can't do it because everybody uses marijuana. I mean, that's an overstatement, but a wide number of people use marijuana. And they look like the people on Capitol Hill. Even though the people on Capitol Hill use methamphetamine, believe me, they do. But the association is with them. Like crack cocaine, the association was with black people, even though more white people use it. When you attach a drug to a despised group, now you can make some incredible stories about that drug. Now, I'll say one thing that even though we have those big billboards out in Montana, Wyoming, one of the things that has happened in terms of legislation is that they've taken a very different approach than what was taken with crack cocaine. So still, no drug has been punished more harshly than crack cocaine. And in some places like Montana, the harshest they punish their folks for methamphetamine possession is like a year in jail and with treatment. Can you imagine somebody proposing that happen with crack? No. But there are places, like Oklahoma, they didn't get the white memo. They punished white folks harshly. They are still punishing people harshly for methamphetamine. So, there's some difference in how we deal with that.
Dr. Hart, hi. Centers of Gerontological Carcinogenesis, predominantly female-based, and so I wanted to know, is your data basically the same in terms of outcomes when we look at gender differences?
So when we think, when we talk about the lab data, the prison data, which data? The lab data?
Lab data.
So I don't really do gender work in the lab. Other people have, and not very well. There haven't been many gender differences reported with methamphetamine that I'm aware of, but I know that literature less. But outside of the lab, I know that like black women were the fastest growing prison population.
We have another question from online. Can you talk about how drug addicts had pre-existing life problems, for instance, poverty, depression, that led to drug abuse rather than drugs causing these problems?
Yeah, so when we think about reasons why people are addicted to drugs, there are multiple reasons that people are addicted to drugs. Co-occurring psychopathology, of course, you have to deal with the psychopathology. If you deal with the psychopathology, maybe you'll deal with the drug addiction. Other reasons that people are addicted for drugs, less alternative reinforcers, less
responsibility skills, a wide range of reasons are why people are addicted. Quite frankly, one of the things about the book that I had to make sure I did was, this is not a book about addiction. Addiction has gotten too much attention as it is. This is a book about understanding drugs, not drug addiction. The drug addiction industry is one of the reasons that we're in this mess that we're in today. She has the microphone. Ed, you have microphone? Let's stand up, Ed.
Well, we don't really hear it. I'm just wondering, you talked about, you know, marginalized or poor, black or Latino, populations are not just used strategies. What do you think about reactions to, like, knowledge, for example, that's in the media with knowledge virus, and which seems to be, you know, in use in more than the rest of the what's your thinking about, you know, how do we react and respond to the general reaction to that? And I think a second question I have is just around messaging. I understand what you're saying about science and research. I was struck by the comments about the BBC and the support of the people. So, like, you know, if you had, like, you know, three or four things you could say to the Rosa Black Caucus and after the news issues of the digital platform for our Republican activists, what would those three or four advisors be?
You didn't hear me. You didn't hear me when I said I don't have time to waste like that. I have no interest in talking. I mean, that's not what I waste my energies on. Your question about Molly, Molly being MDMA, ecstasy. What to say? People use MDMA. They always have. You have a new sort of pop star who is saying that, or new pop star saying that they use it. It'd be nice if we actually educated people how to be safe with it. They use MDMA. The generation before them used MDMA. The generation before them, it's not new. I don't know what to say. It's a drug. Its effects are predictable. We know how to keep people safe. It's useful in those situations in which they use it. That's why they use it.
Hey, Ed Singleton for the Mind Tech Corporation. Let's get back to getting from point A to point B. I'm more curious about what it takes for African American male such as yourself to be the first tenured scientist at Columbia University, and why it took so damn long.
Yeah, so one of the things that I pointed out, and Ed is modest, I pointed out the importance of mentors. Back in 1993, I believe, it was 93 or 94, I was doing my dissertation at the National Institute on Neurological Disorders and Strokes, looking at stress, Parkinson's disease, and I wanted to really study drugs. And I called Ed out of the blue or something, and he was at the National Institute of Drug Abuse in Baltimore, and he invited me there. And he spent the whole day with me, kind of telling me about the area of research, introducing me to all of these prominent scientists who I had read about. And it was one of the most generous sort of acts that anybody had done for me. So it really got me on this pathway. So that was quite nice. Now, that's one of the things that has to happen in order to become me at Columbia. But like you said, being the first, well, why did it take so long? You know, I hate this notion of being the first of anything. You know, in 2009 is when I got tenured. Shouldn't be any more first. And so I think it took so long because we remain a racially segregated society where people in spaces like Columbia and these other places are isolated by this segregation, and they can go away and be ignorant about the impact or not think about that. And so nobody just thinks about it. And so before you know it, it's 2009 and you don't have none and nobody's thought about it. So it's kind of simple to see how it happens. It's kind of the same way that it happens with prisons, with this increase in prison. That's why it's so incumbent upon us, people like me, who are before the public, who know something, to be honest and candid and speak truth when we're in public. Like, now that I'm tenured, I understand what it's like to be a free man. No, that's a real serious statement. I don't know many other black free men in this society. And I love being a free man. There's nothing like it.
Yeah. You spoke about decriminalization. And that if someone gets caught with a gun, you just want to find them. So if we find them, so what keeps them from selling drugs to a child? Or if you just want to find her, she continues to take the drugs. Passing on to every person, number one child. What do we do about that? Now, they do what they do as an adult, whatever
his
choice they make. The child doesn't have
a choice.
Now, the point child doesn't have a choice. So, where are you going to draw the line with decriminalization?
So, you didn't listen to me. So, drug sales remain illegal with decriminalization. And when we talk about people selling to kids, decriminalization are for it's for adults, not children. This is all about adults. And when you think about even that scenario you described, the situation now, that happens now. And we still have this moral crisis going on. So we need an alternative.
Being a D.C. resident, and D.C. recently had changed into a prescription marijuana, but we also had a situation where, similar to your alarm statistics, you're more likely to get arrested for marijuana than D.C. being graduated from high school. And so, decriminalization is something that's of interest to politicians, but I was wondering in terms of other things that go along with that. Decriminalization doesn't take care of all of the problems of the other social environmental things that go along with drug abuse, and it's not the fix. So I wondered about, in your research and thinking about policy issues, science issues, what else needs to go along with the decriminalization, I guess, policies, because, I mean, it's not that there's not still harm from use, and it's not that there's still not social environmental factors that contribute to use, because if you decriminalize, we're not like Portugal. People still have, there's nothing else built in that when that happens. So I wonder if there are any social experience or thoughts you have on what kind of things need to happen as well.
Yeah, thank you for asking that question. So with decriminalization, what I point out in the book is that we have to have a corresponding increase in realistic education. That clip that I showed about methamphetamine, that stuff parades as education in this country. That's not education. When I talk about realistic education, people are informed about the effects of methamphetamine that we need to be concerned if you are a user. Methamphetamine, for example, disrupts sleep. Make sure people are not taking the drug near bedtime. Make sure that people are eating. One of the things that methamphetamine does well is to decrease food intake. Make sure people understand that. When we think about drugs like heroin, 75% of the people who die from a heroin-related death do so because of alcohol being combined with it. Make sure people understand that if you've got to do heroin, don't combine it with another sedative like alcohol. Realistic education, keeping people safe so they can enhance their drug experience rather than causing harm. I'm sorry?
As if there were mandatory labels on drugs, but
No, you don't need mandatory labels. That's kind of, I mean, when we think about alcohol, are there any mandatory labels on alcohol? Of course not. But we have built into our culture TV, commercials, think about movies, TV shows. It is frowned upon if people wake up in the morning and take alcohol in the morning first thing. There are a number of ways you can educate the public about drugs without these labels. Like, start with getting rid of shows like Breaking Bad. Start with getting rid of all of the propaganda related to drugs. I know people are like horrified. I know people are horrified, but there have been few efforts that have done more harm to our drug education than those kind of shows.
We're going to end the take maybe just three quick, hopefully quick questions, Mr. Sharp.
I realize that you're a neuroscientist, but I'm interested in knowing, what is your opinion about efforts like the Harlem Children's Zone, Promise Neighborhood Communities, and the fact that the Washington State Institute for Public Policy found that the state could actually reduce the number of prisons by two to be built, given the evidence on evidence-based prevention interventions in early childhood?
You know, I don't know enough about the details of, like, children zone Harlem. I don't know enough to really comment on those sorts of things. If you have a specific question that you want to ask me about it, I don't know about these programs. Comment, and I don't want to engage in an exchange of ignorance that seems to be going around.
Hi, my name is Kitty Brady, and I grew up in Harlem in the 80s, so I really know about the drug epidemic. And there are a lot of people who are there who are in my age range who feel like, you know, sometimes drugs is the only way out, or they don't have the same educational opportunities. Even if they're given opportunity, they don't take it. And for me, being somebody who was educated, and I try to go back and I try to tell people, they don't care, they don't want to listen. And I'm not a psychologist, I'm not a scientist. You know, what can I do to get my peers as excited about this as I am to try to get involved in some way?
So, I guess you have to meet people where they're at. One of the things that goes on in the country is, well, I mean, you're talking about black people, right? So when we think about, I think about, like you say, you grew up in Harlem and you were there. You know, I grew up in the hood too, and I thought I knew something, and I was ignorant. I was bamboozled. And until I started to learn, and I learned from a variety of sort of sources. From music, people like Gil Scott Heron, he was from Harlem. Well, he's not from Harlem, but he lived in Harlem. And he had a critique about American society that resonated with me in music. Bob Marley talked about how we were stolen from Africa and what that means now. All of these things began my education. I started to read James Baldwin. I read people like John Edgar Wideman. All of these people had a critique, a thoughtful critique on the society. And so that, but I had to be met first with music because I wasn't reading. And so you meet people where they're at. And I hope that the book actually plays a role in that eventually.
Hi, Dr. Hart, Taylor again. Question in a kind of a challenge, I guess, today. And I'm following up on your take home messages to be prepared to alter our actions. So, if you know, plans for blogging, social media, how does that play into you helping us to get the message out? Don't know if you have a blog, but if so, let us know. And I guess the challenge part is to the ABA. This is a wonderful message to kind of get out there, and especially the data that people need to fight ignorance. And so first, tell us about your social media and then how you help ABA and social media to get get a campaign going around.
So one of the things that has happened as a result of the book, I get invited to write op-eds now and every now and then. I wrote a piece for the New York Times related to the Trayvon Martin case when they brought in the marijuana. And I had an opportunity to speak from a scientific perspective about why the claims that they were making were inconsistent with evidence. Recently, I wrote a piece in The Nation about the marijuana movement and how the marijuana movement has not attended to race. They've been apathetic when it comes to racial discrimination. And in that piece, I also talked about scientists, us, being apathetic to racial discrimination. So these kind of popular pieces, I've been writing quite a bit. I blog for The Monitor. Not The Monitor, I'm sorry, Psychology Today. I blog for them. I apologize.
Okay.
Yeah, so I've been, I'm trying to have a presence in the sort of the world in which I can make contact with just the general public.
Thank you. A lot of people are following others on Twitter, so that's another.
And I'm on Twitter.
Okay.
And I'm on Twitter.
Okay, we can make it.
My Twitter account is at Dr. Carl Hart. Doctor is Dr. Carl Hart. Follow me on Twitter. I never thought I'd be saying this in public.
It is a new behavior. It is a new thing that we're all happy to do.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.